Screen Wipe, a programme all about television, consisting of reviews of other shows, features about the ghastly backside of television, and loads of other stuff that we've chucked in. I'm Charlie Brooker, and I am your host.
I love 24. I love it more than I'd love, say, a child of my own. I love every ridiculous bone in its body, which is why I'm so pleased that season 5 is here and it's just as preposterous and exciting as ever. This series opened in style by cheerfully culling several of its major characters. First, former President David Palmer took a bang-bang in the necky-weck. Then, CTU office sweethearts Tony and Michelle got all blowed up. This brought 24's main hero, Jack Bauer, out of hiding. He'd been pretending to be dead for reasons too dumb to explain. While previous series have centred around rather simple stop the bomb sort of storylines, this year we've been given a convoluted conspiracy theory terrorist scheme plot thing, which is so convoluted it would take me 24 hours to explain the bloody thing. Anyway, suffice to say, so far it's involved shootouts, canisters of nerve gas, a tiny sinister man who seems to live inside the Windows operating system, and a snivelling 15-year-old bell-end called Derek, whose repeated misfortune has been a joy to behold.
That's right, Derek! Human blood!
As per 24 tradition, Jack is aided and abetted by the team back at CTU. Back in the first series, CTU seemed like an incredibly glamorous place full of beautiful people. Now it's a lot more normal. You've got a grumpy female geek, you've got Master Frodo's mate, and you've got Fred Flintstone. My favourite new character has to be President Charles Logan, who actually looks like a spitting image puppet of Richard Nixon. He's fascinatingly shifty and spineless. Sometimes it's like watching Blackadder, the White House years.
I feel awkward mentioning this.
Yeah, I'd give it 10 minutes if I were you. Anyway, as ever, the show itself is a beguiling mix of unbearable tension and hilariously bad soapy interludes.
Jack.
Spit it out!
Is it true what she said?
What'd she say?
That you still love me.
Yeah, look, can we do this tomorrow? It's just so I'm on the trail of some nerve gas. Jack Bauer there is a man of extremes. He spends half his life shouting,
"Where is it?"
and the other half whispering gruffly and nodding and looking around.
So sorry about David Palmer. I know how much he meant to you.
What?
I need to stay here. CTU still needs my help.
What? Jack's main hobby is torture, which he always seems to relish a little bit more than is strictly necessary.
First thing I'm going to do, I'm going to take out your right eye. Move over and I'm gonna take out your left and I'm gonna cut you. I'm gonna keep cutting you until I get the information that I need. You understand me? So for the last time, where is the nerve gas?
Sorry, run that by me again. You're gonna start with my right eye, then you're gonna take out my left eye, then you're gonna keep cutting and cutting and cutting. Okay.
Stop! 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 I'll turn.
No, not the eye bag! God, this is like 10 years younger. Anyway, day 5 of 24 may be only a quarter of the way in, but it's already as dementedly addictive as ever. It's a bit like a bag of pistachio nuts, really. You have to keep reaching for one more, and before you know it, your table's covered in empty shells and your fingers stink of salt. Actually, that's where the analogy breaks down. According to people in telly, it's a cardinal sin for a programme to be too in, by which they mean too concerned with the workings of TV itself. That's the theory. In practice, you can be as in as you like, provided you're being a cheerleader, provided all you're effectively saying is, isn't telly brilliant? Yes, there's nothing TV loves more than giving itself a great big self-celebratory blowjob.
It was shocking and new for people. They hadn't been taken into that world.
My goodness, are they watching it?
It was perfect Saturday morning viewing.
A programme like that goes on air and it just changes the zeitgeist, the zeitgeist, the zeitgeist.
I was able to affect people all over the world in whatever language. People need heroes. People need dads.
The Switch Boys were jammed after episode 2. I don't think the BBC had ever had so many calls.
It was the first programme about 20-something life that didn't
patronise the viewer.
The most nauseating example so far has to be the group hug that followed Jamie's school dinners.
For months, the celebrity chef, Jamie Oliver, has been on a crusade.
So has one celebrity chef made the difference?
OK, policy change notwithstanding, let's not lose sight of the fact that the programme was ultimately a piece of entertainment. An entertainment for middle-class smuggos whose kids don't eat turkey Twizzlers anyway. The sort of people who work in telly, in other words.
Well,
thank God, if it hadn't been for the TV series, all those children would have died! After Jamie's school dinners went out, teletypes were falling over themselves, babbling on about socially active programming and stuff like that. A backslapping circle jerk that finally reached crescendo at last year's National Television Awards.
Sir, would you tell us who it is?
Yes, it's my son. It's Jamie Oliver.
It's not the fact that Jamie Oliver is a great chef or champion of good cooking that makes him special. It's his love of people.
You've always been my champion and your mother's champion. But now you're the champion of the millions of children of this country.
Jamie Oliver!
He's used the power of television to change things for the better in our homes, in our schools, and in our country.
With TV taking itself that seriously, it's no wonder it treats members of the normal non-telly public with such little regard.
At the end of your training, a lucky few of you will be sent into orbit.
Yet when something bad happens to someone from the world of television, we get this sort of thing.
It's the week the nation mourned one of its most popular television presenters. Martin Frizzell's in Jill's hometown of Weston-super-Mare in Somerset. Morning, Martin. How's the community coping?
Esther, good morning. Put it this way, when I was here at the start of the week after Jill's murder, you just had to mention her name to people and they would openly weep tears. Last night when I came back and you mentioned Jill's name again, there was silence from people and then they'd say, dreadful, dreadful.
Actually, you don't have to die to provoke a sense of tragedy. Just present your final edition of something.
I just want to say thank you to everyone. I can't do it.
No, don't worry.
But most importantly, I want to thank you for sharing this incredible experience with me, for sharing my highs and lows, and for your amazing letters and cards of support. I hope to see you all again very soon, but for now, all I want to say is...
And whoever gets my job, you've got the best job in the world because you're working for her, which is just...
No, you're the best.
Fantastic.
Yes, TV is by far the greatest, most positive force in the universe, and every moment of it is so f***ing precious, which is why I'm sorry to tell you that this little bit of it is over. According to sales figures, everyone in the country's got a Little Britain DVD. It's like they're being issued by the government. But it's not the only comedy series available on Shiny Disc. Here's three I'd recommend which you might not be aware of. First, 15 Stories High, Sean Locke's surreal, understated council estate sitcom, which aired a few years back on BBC's 2 and 3, if you could find it.
That plaster come off you?
Yeah.
Well, eat it.
Criminally overlooked and extremely funny, this is well worth grabbing on DVD. Next up, US sitcom Arrested Development, which charts the woes of the frankly deserving of misery Bluth family. It's just been cancelled in the States, but it's still available on disc, at least until the powers that be snatch up every copy and catapult them into the sun.
I'll mail that letter.
Job had not mailed the letter, but in an act of defiance, dramatically hurled the letter into the sea.
Sharp, quick, and often bloody silly. Oh, it's a peach! Finally, US sketch comedy Mr. Show, which hasn't even been shown over here and is only available on import. An unashamed tribute to Monty Python, it stars Bob Odenkirk and David Cross in a series of wacky, in a good way sketches, which vary in quality, but when they hit, they hit.
Now, Ryan, my students, questions, queries, quests!
Mr. Dorn, I'm a dramatic director student here at the Institute. I heard you plan to go to France soon. My question is...
Who dares question, Ryan Dorn!
If you want to see it, you'll have to order it Region 1 from America, because no one's bothered to broadcast it this side of the pond, the c***s!
We've had game shows based on pretty much any subject you can think of. We've had game shows based on bingo.
Look at the number on your middle line that you like best.
Game shows based on roulette. And we've had game shows based on The Wicker Man. But never have we seen a game show based on the Copenhagen interpretation of quantum mechanics, until now. Obviously, I'm talking about Deal or No Deal, the astoundingly pointless afternoon quiz in which contestants agonise over what might or might not be inside a series of sealed red boxes.
But there is a belief here. There's a large sum of money in box number one.
Just like Schrodinger's potentially dead cat, the contents of each box exist in a sort of theoretical superposition that fluctuates between pittance and fortune, until the box is actually opened, at which point reality assigns it a value in the physical world, and the audience either goes, hooray! Or, hooray. In other words, basically, it's just a guessing game. Not that you'd ever guess that, given the way that host Noel Edmonds carries on.
We're going to keep the 100,000 and the 50,000 until the very end. All right, Sam? So if you just stick with that strategy for us...
There is no strategy here. OK, maybe a bit, deciding when to quit. But the only one with a clear game plan here is Noel himself. He's like a man in a drama workshop who's been asked to improvise the part of a fevered id flipping a series of coins. We don't want heads. This next one mustn't be heads. I don't want to see heads. Mustn't see heads. Mustn't see heads.
Please, open box 9. 50p.
Yes! It's tails! Thank God! Thank God! Thank God! Okay, okay. Next coin.
Open
don't want to
15,
see heads.
Please.
Don't want to see heads. Don't want to see heads.
Oh, no!
Oh, God! I'm going to kill myself! Kill myself and I'm going to kill you! Even though the game really only exists inside Noel's head, he continually ratchets up the tension throughout, and he pretty much gets away with it.
Yes, I do like this situation. Watch her face really closely. Risk management. I think we've got to brace ourselves here. Hello.
That's Noel talking to the banker who's not really there. Anyway, even though it doesn't actually exist, Deal or No Deal has been exported around the world, most recently to the USA. The American version is a bit more gung-ho than ours. We get a bearded DJ opening suitcases in a pokey Bristol studio, and they get this. We get this. They get this. We get this. They get this. Big guy even gets to speak to the banker on a cordless phone.
Hello.
Not like the vintage Bakelite bullshit that Noel has to use. Hello, is that the 1930s? Yes, could you stop the Second World War happening, please?
That was a setback. That was a serious setback.
At the end of the day, Deal or No Deal has a lot in common with 24. They both feature continuous, suspenseful music, phone conversations with shadowy individuals, and they're both great big illusions. Deal or No Deal is, in many ways, a show that isn't really there. When you watch it, you're simply staring into a void. The deep, dark, unforgiving void.
Nicky Campbell was born in Edinburgh in 1961. After studying history at Aberdeen University, Campbell gained his first position in the media as a jingle writer for Scotland's North Sound Radio, eventually rising to present The Breakfast Show. He moved to London and joined Capital Radio. It was 1986, the year of the Challenger disaster and the Chernobyl meltdown. Yet despite this carnage, Campbell's career went from strength to strength. Within a year, he joined BBC Radio and broadcast to an entire nation. There he stayed for a full decade, until 1997, when he unexpectedly moved to 5 Live, where he remains to this day. But radio isn't the only side to this former Scottish baby's bow. In his capacity as a TV presenter, Campbell has worked on Wheel of Fortune, Newsnight, and Top of the Pops. He currently hosts Watchdog. Campbell is also a keen runner, and in the year 2000 ran the London Marathon in aid of a landmine charity. His time, 3 hours and 20 minutes. So what next for the Scottish broadcaster? Only one person truly knows. Campbell himself.
Now here's Dr. Ben Goldacre looking at some bad science.
The problem with science on television is there isn't actually any science on television. They've got all these things which they claim are science documentaries, but they're too scared to put any actual science in them. In the case of Horizon, they're horror stories about how we're all going to die. Meanwhile, on Channel 4, they're running some kind of freak show. The baby with two heads, the twin that gave birth to itself. I honestly wonder why they don't just go back to the 18th century and start charging people tuppence to poke at the freaks through the bars of their cage. Meanwhile, they've got these people with sort of correspondence course PhDs from non-accredited colleges in America. I mean, when was the last time that you heard somebody talking about chlorophyll or photosynthesis on national television? You wouldn't get it in a science show, but with Gillian McKeith saying you should eat lots of dark green leaves because that will really oxygenate your blood, you get it at 8 o'clock prime time television. Chlorophyll in chloroplasts only makes oxygen if it's in sunlight. There's no sunlight in your gut. The only way that spinach is going to make oxygen in your bowel is if you stick a torchlight up your arse. And even then, you don't have gills in your bowel. I mean, it's just preposterous fantasy. And she struts about in a white coat in a laboratory next to racks of electronic equipment as if she knows what she's talking about. The thing about alternative medicine, the evidence as it was called, is that the tone throughout is, I'm a scientist. I was a skeptic when I started out, and now my mind has completely been swayed. There was one bit where somebody is apparently having open heart surgery with acupuncture alone for anaesthetic. If you really pay attention to the programme very carefully, you can just about work out that the patient has had huge amounts of local anaesthetic and lots of pre-medication before they have this open heart surgery. But everybody I spoke to came away thinking that what they'd seen was somebody having open heart surgery with acupuncture, as if this was amazing proof of the extraordinary efficacy. I just don't buy that. Even in the advert breaks, you get flaky science. You get things like, you know, the Silit Bang ad, where they say it gets rid of limescale, which is calcium carbonate, and we can prove that by chucking a lump of calcium metal into a dish of Silit Bang. You chuck a lump of calcium metal into a dish of water, and it will do that. Any metal from the group on the periodic table that calcium's in is going to do that if you chuck it in water. What I want to see for science on telly is a proper show that says, here's an interesting new idea and here's the evidence for and against, because that's what science is all about. If they can't give me, here's an idea and here's the evidence, then I'm just not interested.
Now, have you ever watched TV and thought to yourself, oh, for God's sake, can't we do better than this? I mean, we've built cathedrals. Surely we can come up with something better than yet another light-hearted detective show in which Martin Clunes runs around the hay wain solving shit crimes, or some edgy comedy prank series in which a grinning youth presenter farts into the mouth of dying OAPs and then runs away cackling. Why is there so much on-air bibble? And come to think of it, why is so much bibble replicated time and time again? Surely there's better televisual songs to sing? Well, the good news is there are. The bad news is the world doesn't work in their favour. Let's say you've got a groundbreaking idea for a show about a Cockney Cyclops in a fez. You think it's brilliant. But if there's going to be any chance of it getting on TV, you'll have to convince a commissioning editor that it's brilliant too. Commissioning editors are TV's primary gatekeepers, the first ones who'll say yes or no to your idea. And they're always under intense pressure to continually jizz out a string of hit shows. The moment they hear about your poxy Cockney Cyclops in a fez, a billion different thoughts occur to them. Thoughts like,
hang on, wasn't there a show 3 years ago where Patrick Kilty wore a fez and didn't that rate badly? Does he have to be a Cyclops at all? Could he be Martin Clunes instead? Yeah, and the audience doesn't like Cockney, so let's put him somewhere in the Pennines. That'd be handy, because we've got to get our regional quota up.
No, oh, actually, bollocks to all that. Let's just make it a reality thing where a naked celebrity has to live in a barn full of tramps. And then 6 months down the line, when you're toiling away on your celebrity tramp barn thing and trying not to kill yourself, a rival channel inevitably comes out with a show about a Cockney Cyclops, which turns out to be a huge hit and was commissioned by a man who didn't ask any awkward questions at all because he spends all his time sitting behind his desk doing this. But surely not all commissioning editors are either overcautious or just outright insane, are they? Oh, let's make one up and ask them.
End of the day, your commissioning editor, right, just looking for that one hit show, what's going to stop them being sacked? That's why every instinct is shrieking, play it safe, sunshine, at you.
Does it use any particular voice?
What do you mean?
Well, does it use the voice of a girl or does it use the voice of a haunted well? Does it go, oh, play it safe?
Oh, I don't get you.
Sorry, that was a very stupid question. Still, it's not fair to simply blame the commissioners like they're the Daleks or something. It's fairer to blame the entire TV industry's idiotic obsession with ratings and demographics. The channels will often send out a sort of shopping list detailing exactly the kind of viewer they're hoping to attract. Here's a typical example. We need to attract more 16 to 34-year-old males to our post-watershed slot. ABC One's urbane, reasonably affluent, interested in extreme sports, love shoes, hate hats, eat chips, once threw up on a swing, blah, 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 and so on. Trouble is, the moment you tailor your content to a demographic like that, you're doomed. You're chasing a fictional average schmo who doesn't really exist in the real world. All right, people in marketing might disagree with that, but f*** them, they're idiots. Here's proof. Chasing a demographic ideal is like, well, it's like when your grandmother tries to buy you a Christmas present when you're in your 20s and all she knows about you is that you're a man in his 20s, so she goes out and she buys you a big book about football. But you hate football. Well, you do if you're me. So Granny done wasted her time.
Of course, right, at the end of the day, your commissioning aid, right, is only as good as the ideas people bring them, and most of the time they're only coming in with a load of rehashed old toot ideas that they've seen elsewhere they think you're going to buy rather than anything they're actually interested in. That's why you end up with a schedule full of interchangeable bloody smush. Can I say smush?
You can say smush, yeah.
Yeah, interchangeable bloody smush that, well, okay, passes the time, but ultimately it don't spellbind no one, does it?
Well, no, apart from the readers of Hooray for Smush magazine, that is.
So there you have it. Sorry, but it's a system inadvertently designed to help foster the bland. All the more reason then to appreciate the rare sparks that aren't bland. Well, I'm not talking about this, by the way. I mean proper telly. There's probably some of that on the other side right now. Sorry for wasting your time. I really am sorry. All right, what do you want me to do? All right, I'll try and entertain you. I'll do you a little puppet show. How about that, eh? Is that better? Has that made it up to you? Has it? You f***ing assholes!
Now on BBC One, more from the animal hospital.
They land, they go, like that. Damage all the ones here.
Oh, yeah.
You rarely hear about the advantages of suicide on TV for some mad regulatory reason, but here's one. If you kill yourself, you never have to get up in the f***ing morning ever again, which means you never have to watch breakfast f***ing television either.
Hello, good morning. This is Breakfast with Kate Silverton and Simon McCoy.
Good morning, it's Thursday.
Now, I've never quite understood the need for any kind of TV in the mornings at all, since TV is a medium that basically prevents you from doing anything other than just dumbly staring at it like that. And since the morning is a time when, generally, you've got loads of things to do, the two things don't really seem to go. But if you will persist, what are your choices? Well, on BBC One, you've got a show imaginatively titled Breakfast. There's something unsettling about that name. I think it's just too simple. And it means that sometimes they say things like, hello, you're watching Breakfast.
Hello, very good morning. You're watching Breakfast with Dermot Manahan and Natasha Kaplinsky.
It's just weird. What's more, the show as a whole is so insipid and polite that watching it is a bit like attending a particularly bland coffee morning in heaven.
Chocolate, so
only the finest.
Dear. Yeah, Dermot, thank you. £2.99.
Meanwhile, over on ITV, it's not ITV at all, it's GMTV. The gaudy way to start your day. There's something inherently cheap-looking about GMTV. It's like waking up in a travelodge full of needlessly obsequious people.
7.22 is the time, an ungodly hour for an actor of such fine calibre to be getting up in the morning. Matthew Modine is in the studio.
What's your chitter-chatter?
Do you ever
hear it.
No, you don't, actually.
Never,
it's not a popular phrase at the moment, is it?
Of course, the problem with trying to keep things that neurotically bubbly at all times in a show that also deals with quite unpleasant news topics is you're often left having to make crunchingly awkward tonal shifts.
We're also looking at debt and what you should do if you find yourself unable to pay the bills after cases of those who have felt the need to kill themselves or commit suicide because they're so scared about debt. We want to make sure those kind of tragedies don't happen again. There's always help out there.
Yeah, absolutely. And as well as that, we're going to be catching up with actors Mark Charnock and the lovely Verity Rushworth, who are just about to tie the knot, maybe, of Marlon and Donna in Emmerdale.
Yeah, so please don't kill yourself because we've got some c*** off Emmerdale turning up. Speaking of GMTV, their former stalwart Eamon Holmes can now be found fronting Sky News' Sunrise. Weirdly, Eamon delivers some of the news while standing up behind a desk, which just makes him look like he's working in a shop. Anyway, all of this is a bit too urgent for my liking. My ideal morning show would consist of nothing but just some warm, soothing colours and a voice gently bidding me to wake up. And in the absence of that, I'm prepared to settle for Milkshake on Channel 5.
With some of these. Lucy Fisher, you're first, you're two today.
Oh, see, in the mornings I've got a mental age of about two, so this sort of thing is pretty much all I can cope with. My favourite part of Milkshake is an imported Australian show called High Five, which stars a Steps-like band whose relentless chirpiness I find weirdly moving at that time of day. Nice to see the sign language for is... There's not a single negative word or thought throughout the entire programme. It's the single most positive thing you will ever bloody see.
Sweet little puppies, it's been a big day.
Do you know my favourite things?
Yeah, okay, so it's a bit like being cuddled to death by a giant marshmallow teddy bear. But hey, come on, anything that can stop me just slashing my wrists open and ending it there and then in the mornings has got to be performing some kind of valuable public service. Well, it has in my f***ing opinion.
On next week's show, some old continuity. Anthea Turner might chin someone and TV gets seriously frightening.
The film you're about to see shows what happens when a 1 megaton nuclear bomb explodes over central London. A third-degree burn through the full thickness of the skin looks like this.
Jesus Christ!